This is Tom Kane, governor of the state of New Jersey, and I'd like to welcome you to Rutgers University. Rutgers was founded in 1766, before the American Revolution, as one of the original colonial colleges. Today, it serves as the State University of New Jersey, a modern, vibrant academic center whose reputation grows stronger every year. Rutgers blends the new along with the rich tradition of academic and athletic excellence. Rutgers has a lot to offer in the classroom and on the field. It's an ideal place for the student athlete. I'm pleased to introduce the 1987 Rutgers University football highlight film. And I hope you find Rutgers, New Jersey, and you perfect together.
RU football in 1987 was again reaching for the very top in college football. It is a program going above and beyond the ordinary in their quest for success. There is a fiery feeling of anticipation on this team, a team which has a belief and a pride in themselves that reflects a true commitment to excellence. A feeling which sends the Scarlet Knights into a new era of football here at Rutgers. A program on the rise. It should be noted that the 1987 Rutgers football season actually kicked off on September 3rd, when dedication ceremonies took place officially opening the sparkling $7 million Hale Center. Standing on the east side of Rutgers Stadium, this football training and office complex offers to the Scarlet Knights student athlete a truly first-class facility. Inside, the brand new players' lounge, immense locker rooms, coaches' offices, meeting rooms, state-of-the-art training room, and strength and conditioning center all stand as evidence of the university's commitment to both the program and the player.
The Rutgers University's commitment to a Division I-A program is ongoing. As the state university, our facilities, our coaching staff, our scholarship program, our faculty-student involvement are all key ingredients to making us not only a program of representation, but an attractive program to those who want to join us in our thrust to become one of the majors in Division I-A football.
New Jersey's team traveled to Ohio for its season opener against Cincinnati and proceeded to cage the Bearcats for the third year in a row. Playing under an ominous full moon, junior tailback Henry Henderson ran as if his life depended upon it. Using his considerable speed and frightening determination, this Akron, Ohio native took the ball 24 times and then burst, bullied, and broke loose for 199 rushing yards. The Scarlet offensive line of Steve Tardy, Ivan Gurria, Nick Erta, Bill Hyros, Bill DeBeal, and Doug Strickland buried their opposition, helping the Hammer gain more than 8 yards every time he touched the ball. His opening night performance helped open the skies for the Rutgers passing game, which saw quarterback Scott Ernie hit Brian Cobb for the first Scarlet score of the season. As the night descended, Carmen Sclafani kicked a 41-yard field goal, the first of his career, providing all the points necessary for a Rutgers victory. At the same time, the night defense was haunting quarterback Danny McCoyne like a bad dream. This Heisman hopeful was hounded and harassed on his way to being sacked 4 times and throwing interceptions to cornerback and co-captain Gene Austin and linebacker Alec Hope. In the second half, McCoyne would not even be able to drag his team inside Rutgers territory, giving the Scarlet Knights their second opening day win in as many years. A win over the Southeastern Conference Kentucky Wildcats brought Rutgers back into Giant Stadium as a team of destiny. On a night better fit for flippers and paddles and footballs and helmets, Rutgers was aiming for the 500th victory in their history, with only the Blue Devils of Duke standing in their path.
Keep the clock for the waist, watch it on the side. Break, break.
From the start, it would be a test for the RU defense. Duke came into this contest averaging over 30 points per game, but the weather and the willpower of New Jersey's team ended all that. On the Devils' very first possession, Sean Washington stepped in front of his receiver and quickly stopped any thoughts of a Duke aerial attack. Duke would gain only 60 yards in the air, watching as the Scarlet Knight front line of Alec Hoke, Carter Giles, Scott Miller, Chuck Paw, and Chris Evans spent much of the time in the Devils' backfield, causing three turnovers and recording their first shutout of the season. With the defensive mission complete, it was now up to the offensive squad to write some history of their own.
Keep holding on to the ball, keep being running, keep going, and we'll be all right.
The driving rain had forced this contest down to its simplest form. The type of duel which saw Dick Anderson's commitment to fundamental football pay off. Starting on their own 25-yard line, Rutgers began a fourth-quarter drive fueled by pure spirit and determination. It was the second and third efforts of running backs Henderson and Mike Boddy which carried the ball downstream. Then, from the 2-yard line, the hammer pounded into the end zone for the game's only score, sending the Blue Devils back to the drawing board and the victorious Scarlet Knights into a noisy and jubilant locker room.
Showed something today, man. You really showed something. You wanted that football game. You overcame a lot of adversity out there today. You hammered them. You do what had to be done. You did a heck of a job. So great job, are you?
With the 7-0 victory over Duke, Rutgers joined an elite group of 500 win programs. The Rutgers tradition stretches from the very first collegiate football contest right into the heart of the National Football League. In 1986, Rutgers was the only school to list two All-Pro players among its alumni. Number 20, Deron Cherry, an All-Pro defensive back for the Kansas City Chiefs. And number 71, Bill Pickell, who as nose guard for the Los Angeles Raiders, still has within him that Scarlet Knight defensive instinct. A fatal attraction for the opposing team's ball carrier. Although the football tradition here dates back 118 years, the academic legacy at Rutgers University reaches back farther still. Today, its rich and unique heritage among our nation's institutions can be seen by the type of student who calls RU home. Rutgers is among the country's top-ranked universities in such areas as economics, engineering, English and computer sciences. Adding to its academic attractiveness are the opportunities which its central New Jersey location offers to a young person.
You can do just about anything you want to do. Where New Brunswick is located, it's right between New York and Philadelphia, so you can go to either city, you know, if you like the nightlife or, you know, you just want to get away for a weekend.
Whether getting away means to the big city or to the Jersey Shore, experiencing the excitement of Atlantic City, or simply sharing time with friends on campus, Rutgers University seems to offer the best of all possible worlds. The focus of every football program has to be the head coach, and Dick Anderson is clearly at the center of this one. His honesty and integrity stand at the forefront as he leads his teams into a new era of winning football. He is both a teacher and a role model to those young men who play the game to which he has dedicated his life.
Football has occupied a major portion of my life for a very good reason. I really believe in the game of football. I believe in it because of the things that youngsters can learn from the game. I hope that when youngsters leave our program that they'll leave with a good sense of values, with a good work ethic, with the ability to work with others, with a sense of discipline and organization. I hope that they'll be able to deal with people after having to work with the squad and being able to interrelate with that squad as well as coaches, so that when they go into the workforce, they'll know how to handle things.
As a person, he is dynamic. He'll bring the best out of you.
And he teaches you how to, you know, work at things off the field, like outside of football.
You learn that, you know, you have to go out every day and work hard to accomplish something that may be weeks or months, you know, down the road. And you have to understand that in the business world, everything isn't, you know, cut and dry and this and that. You have to work constantly for a goal, and if you don't work correctly, then you won't achieve your goal.
Dick Anderson has set some lofty goals for the Rutgers program and for the individuals involved in it. Goals which require hard work, a winning attitude, a total team effort, and a desire to be the very best that you can be. Qualities which once learned on the football field will last long after the final practice whistle is heard.
We've got the red versus the black, pass scrim.
From the practice fields to the playing field, Coach Anderson demands and gets the best from his teams. In 1987, he adapted his offense to take advantage of the talent in both his wideouts and his rapidly maturing quarterback, Scott Ernie. Against Penn State, Anderson would unleash an aerial attack unprecedented in Beaver Stadium history. On this day, Ernie would break Doug Flutie's three-year-old passing records, completing 32 of 55 passes, three of them for touchdowns. His offensive line provided him with the time to connect with nine different receivers, racking up 356 yards in total offense. Tight end Bruce Campbell led the way with nine receptions and one touchdown, with both Henry Henderson and Brian Cobb also scoring for the Knights. The record-breaking performance against the defending national champions in 1987 was once again proof positive that the Scarlet football program is on the rise.
You look at our schedule, you'll find out that it's a very challenging schedule and also gives you variety. Not only do we play the major powers in the East each year with the Penn States and the Pitts, but we also get to play outside the East regularly and go down into the Southeast Conference, and we go out to the Big Ten with Michigan State. And so they get a chance to get variety, they get a very exciting schedule, they get a challenging schedule.
Competing against the schedule of national scope and exposure. Playing inside Giant Stadium, the nation's premier football arena. Performing in front of reporters, radio, and television audiences. These are the ingredients that make up both the opportunities and the challenges of big-time college football.
It doesn't get much bigger than this. we play the best competition in the country, and it's that simple. I mean, we played the national champions last year, and you can't find a program with a better mix of athletics and academics anywhere.
Academically, study halls, tutors, and even a computer lab are made available to the players by a staff whose number one priority is education.
Our coaching staff is very involved in the academic progress of our athletes. They're very concerned about their success, and that starts right from the top with Coach Anderson, who is very concerned about every kid on the team, whether he's a starter or whether he's a backup performer.
You know, they help us, so it's more like a team, you know, whereas we got to communicate with them and they communicate with us, and that's how we get things done.
Whether in the classroom or the weight room, the Rutgers student athlete has available to him facilities and faculty second to none. Here in the brand new 4,700 square foot training center, Dr. Paul Kennedy has put together a program which offers a tremendous amount of variety for lifting in each particular muscle group. And while both the equipment and the sound system are now state of the art, the message is still clear.
Just take a deep breath, work your way up, last word. Be proud, stand tall, touch the ground.
This particular room is allowing us the opportunity to train our athletes in a much more comprehensive fashion, using a much larger variety of techniques and modalities. And the bottom line, I think, is that by increasing the strength of all their musculature, making sure that they're more flexible, and having them coached properly on the field, we now have a more efficient football player.
Don't quit on me. Don't quit, Sid.
For a player, the sweat of the weight room, the dog days of practice, and the time spent in preparation all hang together in the emotional hours before a kickoff. For the 1987 Scarlet Homecoming, the third largest crowd in Rutgers Stadium history arrived ready to shake, rattle, and roll their nights past the Boston College Eagles. Things were quieter on the sideline, though, where Coach Anderson witnessed an inspired BC team jump out to a 10-0 lead. The Scarlet Knights now had to measure the strength of their convictions. Coach Anderson pumped up the defense, while offensive line coach Warren Kogel went back to the basics.
Outside, just make sure you trap that guy on draw slam. Anything else coming off the ball, eyeball the linebacker.
These young men then responded with a total team commitment to victory. Early in the second period, the offense took the field and then proceeded to take the momentum away from the high-flying Eagles. A 27-yard pass and run to Tyrone McQueen highlighted an 81-yard drive, ending in the first of five Scarlet touchdowns for the day.
He's out wide to the right side, or the wide side of the field. Ernie to throw to one of them. That is Young at the 10. Five. Touchdown.
Variety being the spice of life, Rutgers mixed it up on their next possession as no less than seven Knights helped carry the ball downfield for the go-ahead score.
Fourth and goal from the six-inch line. This is Graff. Graff, touchdown!
For Graff, a native of the Boston area, it was his first touchdown as a Scarlet Knight. And it now seemed as though you couldn't even turn your head without missing another Rutgers score.
Back to throw, Ernie. A man wide open, that's Young. Young, open field running, he's free, he could score. At the 15, 10, 5, touchdown, Rutgers!
Eric Young's electrifying race for the end zone saw his hometown crowd go crazy, as BC's chances for victory went up in smoke. While the offense was keeping track of the points on the scoreboard, the defense was busy keeping the Eagles on the ground.
Defense! Rutgers defense!
putting pressure on the quarterback, forcing the turnover. Playing like a team with a mission, this squad effectively shut down Darren Flutie and the Boston College offense for the rest of the game. Upstairs, the offensive staff was following a game plan that called for 526 yards in total offense, including a 62-yard, 14-play drive late in the third period.
Depending upon what happens here, depends upon what we do, okay? Lewis tricks, duck. We're normal. Let's go E. Okay, we're split left.
Split left.
Draw a slam. Red left, 962 shoots. Robert tricks.
Robert tricks.
80 cat.
Everyone wanted a piece of the action now. And next up, it was Henry Henderson to put the finishing touches on this RU victory.
They're leading by seven, 2:38 left. Here's the pitch. Henderson, first down and goal.
Rutgers continued its dominance over the Black Knights of Army this year with a 27-14 victory at Mikey Stadium. Once again, Scott Ernie and his platoon rolled up over 400 yards in offense. Rutgers attacked Army from all fronts. In the air, Ernie completed 14 of 25 passes, while his front line did not allow a sack for the second consecutive game. On the ground, Henry Henderson rushed for 118 yards, scoring once, and helping to set up co-captain Curtis Stevens for two more touchdowns. The Rutgers defense held the nation's fifth-ranked rushing game at bay, not even allowing Army to get close to the goal line for much of the game. The young men of Rutgers had come to West Point with orders to beat these cadets. They left Mikey Stadium with their mission accomplished. Job well done. Rutgers closed out the 1987 season with a win over Temple. The victory again provided the Scarlet Knights with a winning season and a springboard for another year on the rise in 1988. The years spent in college are a special time in any young person's life. A time for learning, for growing, and a time for having fun. Fun on the football field, in the classroom, and in the campus community.
Make sure you find out academically, socially, and then athletically what the school can do for you.
When a player leaves Rutgers University, it's my hope that they will leave, first of all, with a degree, a meaningful degree. Secondly, that they have the feeling that they have come through a program that has tested them mentally, emotionally, and physically, and therefore, as a result, prepare them to deal with the difficult things that come along in life.
For the athlete who becomes a part of the Rutgers University football program, the elements are all in place. The tradition, the commitment, the competition, and the excitement. This formula is completed by a head coach and his staff whose main objective is to make these years the best years of your life.